Hi everybody, it's Christopher Naiman. Today I'm here to teach you how to make this beautiful fiber art wall clock. It is just to die for. It's in a shadow box frame. It's using an embellishing machine and your regular home sewing machine. Metallic threads, we're going to be using an embroidery design from my Amazing Designs collection. And you are just going to have so much fun. I will take you step by step of the process of making this fiber art. So stay with me and get ready to have some fun. Put your feet up, grab a cup of coffee, and take some time to really sit and enjoy the process. Okay, the first thing that we want to start with is a piece of duck cloth. I have a duck cloth that's cut 13 by 13 inches because my shadow box frame is 12 by 12. So I want to give myself a little extra playroom for squaring up and everything when I put it in the shadow box. Now, what I'm using is a felting machine, and this felting machine has barbed wire needles. It's a special machine, and what it does is it marries two pieces of fabric together. What this machine was originally designed for was for using wool roving to felt the wool roving and yarns and things. When I first found this machine and purchased it, I was kind of like, the wool roving thing wasn't for me, and I thought, well, what if I just tack down some fabric to hold in place, because I was doing some fancy fabric pillows. I was doing a Barbara Randall technique of the crazy quilting, and when I tacked it down, it distorted the fabric, and I thought, whoa, wait a minute. You know, like for instance, I would be doing crazy quilting, and I went down like this and took a piece of, well, the fabric we're going to use today is a taffeta, it's acetate from the bridal section, and I absolutely love it. It's really cool. So this is what we're going to be using today, but I want to show you what happened. This was what happened when I first discovered this, and I went and I would tack down. I thought, I'm just going to tack it down, and then it kind of like, well, oh boy, that was kind of stupid of me. I put all these holes in it, but there was really no holes. It's just changing a texture. So I thought to myself, well, wait a minute. So I walked away, came back and looked at it and said, well, that's kind of a cool texture. So what we're going to do with this technique today is I'm going to take this man-made fiber to create a different texture to it. And let me just show you what I do. Well, first of all, as you can see, I have my extension table. Very important when you sew to have your extension table for proper ergonomics. Now, this is a lot of free motion type work. Now, a lot of people are used to doing this, and I did a video on free motion ergonomics that you can watch on my YouTube channel. And the way I like to hold the fabric, though, for me, is to use my two fingers in the 10 o'clock and the 4 o'clock position down here, and I get to move it like this. Now, one thing that people do when they use the felting machine, and you don't want to do it this way when you're doing fancy fabrics like this. I'll see people, they'll go like this, and we call these the jerker or the polka dancers, and you don't want to do this because you're going to grab, the needle's going to embed in there, grab, break, and it's going to break on you. And it's a pain in the butt trying to change these needles. By the way, this machine has 12 needles. I love 12 needles because it has more coverage. So the best way when you're felting, or my terminology for fancy fabrics, I call it punching, is to move it. You can go back and forth like this, back across. You can even do it in a circle. But I like to put the pedal to the metal and then move it in a nice, smooth, fluid motion. And I put this one piece down. Now, the cool thing about this is you don't want to put like perfect square pieces or anything. If you're one of those people that have to follow straight lines all the time, you're not going to have that artistic look. You've got to have your fabric cut in pieces. And it also, when you go to start overlapping, it's going to give texture. Now, there are different fancy fabrics that will give different looks and different textures. This one is what I'm using for this wall clock art. So let me begin and show you how we're going to do this. So I'm going to just keep punching. Now, one thing that's really important is that you don't over punch in one area. If you do, you can create holes. Now, maybe you want the fabric. Sometimes the bottom layer of your duck cloth can show through because you're making it kind of transparent. But what you're doing is you're changing the texture. Now, I'm going to zoom this in here so you can see what I'm talking about. Let me bring this camera down here and zoom this in so you can see the texture, how it's changing. Now, if I show you that and I take a piece that wasn't punched, you can see here's what it looks like there. And as I hold this up and show you, you can see how that texture has changed. It almost gives it like a suede feel. Isn't that pretty cool? So now what we're going to do is we're going to go and start overlapping pieces. And I'm going to take a piece and just cut randomly. And this is going to give you a cool look. Lay it anywhere you want. Now, one thing I want to tell you is that just slightly lay it over your previous spot. This is a lot like traditional crazy quilting, but in a different format and a different type of technique. But the same analogy, same type of idea. Okay, so now I'm going to punch. And don't try to hold it too much in place. Don't try to control it, okay? Just let it do its thing. So I always tell my students when I'm teaching, you know, fiber art is like building a house. You start the foundation, you work your way up. You got to put the foundation in, then the walls, then the roof, and then you decorate and do the landscaping. It's kind of like that with fiber art or anything you build. So now that I'm going through this, you can see how I'm punching it. I'm going very smoothly as I do this. Again, I'm with my needle so I can show you. Again, we don't want to go like this and be erratic about it, because you can tend to, a needle, because it's a barbed wire needle, could catch on that, and as you're moving, you can pull it and break the needle. So there's how we're moving it like that. Now I'm going to take the other piece. I'm going to lay it over here. This is something that you want to do when you're not in a hurry. You cannot be in a hurry to do this. It's a very relaxing process. It's very self-gratifying too when you complete it. If you happen to punch a little too much and you have your duck cloth showing through, you can take a little piece and put over it if you wish. I'm not going to worry about the center as much because we're going to be adding something else over that later. And these edges here, I'm just going to go through. These will be, I'll overlap those also. You can cut those off if you want or just leave them. And the fabric's going to stick, marry itself into the base fabric because this is what felting does. But again, I'm not using the traditional man-made fibers. I'm sorry, the traditional natural fibers. I'm using man-made fibers here. And you can experiment with all different types of fabrics. Now I have people in my class that ask me, can I use a quilting cotton to do this? Well, the quilting cotton's not going to give you the same type of look or texture. You're going to have a whole different look. As you can see, I still have sheen to this, and I'm getting a really fun, different look. You want to experiment with cotton and then buy some fancy fabric, you'll see the difference on your own. I always tell people when they ask me questions, can I do this, can I do that? I say to them, can you? Give it a shot. The way I discovered this was by accident. So you may discover something different as you're using different types of fabrics to create a whole new look for you. So you don't need anybody else's permission to try different things. Go down there and test it. It's like when we make garments. You know, you see the professionals, they will either drape or they'll make a muslin first and then put it on the mannequin, where home sewers will right away want to cut the pattern out with the good fabric, and then they put it on their body and realize it might be too big or too small, and then they get frustrated. It's because they didn't test ahead of time. So testing is good. And you know, in home deck, when you do drapery, they always tell you, measure twice, cut once. It's a way of testing, so you don't make mistakes and waste good fabric. But in fiber art, everything's going to have a different feel, a different hand. And it's not like following a pattern where every line is straight and every dress you make is going to be the same. Fiber art is total freedom. It really, really is. and it's freedom for yourself. It's a self-expression. Each piece will come out different, and it's an expression of yourself. Look, see how it's coming out? The texture is just so cool. Let me see if I can zoom closer here to show you. It's phenomenal. It really is. And then when you feel it, it feels soft and kind of furry. It's really kind of cool. I really love this. It's like I said, I discovered this punching techniques by accident. I was just so thrilled when I finally realized my mistake turned into something wonderful. And that's how my first book, Pillows, was born. I took these punching techniques and used pillows as a canvas to demonstrate all these different type of techniques you can do with a felting machine. So you just keep overlapping. And another thing too is, see this, I got a little bit too long. You don't want to do really big pieces because you want to break it up so you have those little fine lines and give you different, when the light hits each piece in a different direction, it's going to have a different look and reflection to it. Almost kind of like the nap on velvet. If you turn the velvet the wrong way, it's going to give a different appearance. It might look lighter or darker. Same analogy with this. So you're just going to keep building like this. Okay? And I started a piece earlier. I'm going to bring it out here and show you. There's how it gets built up. It gets built up and you have that whole look, and you just keep completing doing this around the whole thing. Now, if you want to see what the back looks like, you could see where it was punched through. You see all that furry? It's really kind of neat. I love it. And that's what it looks like on the back. So it's embedded. It's not going to fall out. And there's the look there. It's just so much fun to do this. It really, really is. So I'm going to continue this, and then we're going to go on to the next step. So you can see how this is coming out so pretty. I mean, it's got the texture, it's got the different dimensions to it as far as the way the light will catch it. It is coming out just incredible. And that's the base. And I have a little bit more to finish up here when we're done with this. And then we'll square it up and we're going to add another centerpiece. So now I'm going to show you some still photos so you can get a better look at the texture of this. Just really pretty. Okay, now I finished the piece and I squared off the edges. You can see how nice that is. I'm gonna hold this up for you. And you know, one thing what I really do appreciate and like about this technique is you get to see all kinds of veins. When you overlap the fabric as you're punching it, you're gonna have all these lines, and they resemble kind of like veins, kind of like marble. If you've ever done any faux texture on your walls, this kind of like give you the same feeling of it. Isn't that neat? And like I said, when you turn it in different directions, it's going to have a whole different look to it. It's a lot of fun. Okay, so the next step is we're going to put a little square piece in the middle, but on a diamond, on a place like a diamond. So I want to find my center, so I'm going to fold this in half this way. And then I'm going to put a fold crease. And then a fold this way, put a little crease there. Okay, now I can see where my center is right there. And then I'm going to just double check that one more time. Remember, measure twice, cut once, but we're not cutting here. We're actually going to punch. It's a whole analogy, though, of understanding and sewing. Okay, and then I'm just going to put a little pin in the middle there so I know where that's at. Okay, and then I've got a 5-inch piece of fabric here, and I got this from the home deck department. It's really nice. Now this has a shiny side and it has a flat side, so depending upon how you want to use it, what you want it to look like, do I want the shiny, do I want the flat side, I think I'm going to go and do the flat side to it. I'm going to put it on the flat side, so I'm going to fold it up this way and fold it up this way. Okay, and then we'll place that center there, feel it with a pin for the center there, put that right there, mark it. Okay, so there's going to be my center. See, it's like a triangle. And next I'm going to punch it. Okay, so now that I have this under my machine, I'm going to remove my pin and I'm going to tack this. Okay, now it's going to hold. I'm going to punch this hole. What was originally a square, we made it a diamond now. See, it's changing the texture, and over here you can see where some of the green is coming through. So I'm going to punch a little more so I get a little bit more speckle of green coming through. And the way you get that is you just overlap it more. In other words, you're just going to keep punching in one spot more. And it's going to heat that fabric up and weaken it just to open it up and spread those fibers apart. I don't want to do a whole lot of it, but I just want enough of it just to give little peekaboos. And you don't have to do this. It's up to you. I mean, it's kind of like a Jackson Pollock. Splash that on, spritz it on. When you're painting, that is. But here, your machine and your needles are your paint with your fabric. So the sky is the limit for whatever you're going to do as your own artist. Like I mentioned, I didn't have to do this, but I want to give a little peekaboos. And the way you get the peekaboos, you keep beating that fabric up. So you see how I just had a little bit of that peekaboo come through? Just like that. So there you have it. That's the second step of this project. Pretty neat, huh? It really is pretty cool. And then we go and we make our clock. It's going to be just neat. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to embroider over this. We're going to embroider one of my designs that I created and start that off there. Okay? That's our next step. Okay, now I've hooped my fabric in my embroidery frame. What I did was I used some sulky spray adhesive for embroidery, and I've got tearaway stabilizer in here, and I've got it in there. So now, something really cool on my embroidery machine is that I can do a camera feature to scan it and tell me exactly where the center is. So I'm gonna hit my little icon here for the camera. And it's telling me I have to put a sticker there, a positioning fabric sticker, to find the center. So got this little positioning fabric sticker, and I'm going to, you can watch me in the camera here, on the position exactly in that box where it tells me to. Okay, so there it is. After I do that, I hit OK, and it says recognizing. All right, and it says detection success. Remove the embroidery position mark, press OK, and start background capture. So I'm going to remove my positioning sticker, and then I'm going to hit OK on my screen. And now it's going to scan this fabric. It's taking a whole picture of what's in the hoop. Isn't that cool? So I can have perfect positioning. Love this feature. That's not taking that long at all. It's just going through the whole thing here. Okay, now it's recognizing, and look at that. There's a picture of it on the screen. Now you see, the embroidery design right there, and it'll tell me where I want to embroider. If I want to position or move it over, I can, but right now it's centered right in the middle of my fabric, and you see how cool and a little bit uneven and distorted the center, the black is? I like that. I'm going to leave it. Now, for all you people who are incredibly perfect, I know a lot of you quilters are my friends out there, and you're going to want that incredibly perfect. You're going to have to let your hair down if you want some artistic look to it. You know, give it a little rough look. But again, you know, it's your choice. So for me, that's fine. I love it. I love it, I love it, I love it. Now, what am I using? I am using to embroider this Madeira jewel thread. That's that sliver metallic thread. Many different companies make this, and I'm using it. And the needle that I have in here is a size 14 top stitch needle, okay? You wanna use a top stitch needle with your thread. So I've got it, I did a video on how to set up your thread, and you can see I have my thread tower, which is made in the USA by Tacone, and the thread is coming off from the bottom. So now I'm going to put my foot down and hit start and watch it go. Isn't it pretty? And that's that metallic thread, that flat thread. It just gives it such a jewel glitter to this. So this is the end of the embroidery, and let's take it out of the frame and move on from there.
Okay, so the next thing we're going to do is some satin stitching. And what I've got here is my finished piece of artwork. And underneath, I put a cutaway stabilizer, an embroidery cutaway stabilizer. I'm going to be using this copper type color thread by Sulky. And my settings on my machine, as you can see, my width is going to be a 4.0. My stitch length is 0.3. And I dropped my tension down to 3.0. I have a satin stitch foot on, and we're going to be doing what I call some lightning bolt stitching. This is going to be really pretty. It's going to add accent. And the choice of color is up to you as the artist. In where I'm going to hang this later after I finish painting my kitchen, I'm going to have a lot of bronze and corals and peach tones and some really deep, deep earth type tones in the faux textures on the wall and stuff. It's going to be really cool. So I'm going to stick with this color with the green, and it's going to look really good. So like I said, whatever color you choose is up to you, but this is that sliver tinsel type thread. This is Sulky I'm going to use today, and this is called, this is a sliver metallic. You can see it right here. It's sliver metallic by Sulky. Okay, so let's get started. Okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to do these lightning bolt satin stitches, and it's really quite simple and very relaxing. If you got some music, put some music on. In fact, I wasn't playing music while I was sewing because I'm making this video, but normally when I do my sewing of my artwork or my bags or my pillows, I have some music on, and music is very relaxing to this. Whenever you're creating, do not try to be in a hurry. You know, that's one of the things, everybody wants to be in a hurry. I hear people saying, I did this in 2 hours, I did this in 1 hour, and they were so excited. It's like, you know, doing something in a little bit of a time is okay, but what's the quality look like? What's the inside look like? You know, so take your time and really finish yourself. So here we go. I'm going to do this satin stitching here, and we're going to do it randomly all over the whole pillow. I'm sorry, the whole wall clock art here. So here we go. It's just a matter of stitching and turning as you go. And I think this one's going to be just about enough right there. I'll stop, cut my thread. I'll go to another section here, and I'll show you this one. It's all when I'm after I get the second one. This is really a cool technique, and it really adds character and that artistic look to it. You can use any color thread that you want. You can use multiple color threads, but like I said, I want to keep it pretty simple because of the colors on my wall. All right, so let me bring this up and show you. So here is what it looks like. See that? It's like a squiggle. I call it like a lightning. Do some more over here. You do them randomly through the whole thing. You don't want to do like a whole bunch. You just want to do enough. So let me go ahead and do some more of this, and then I'll be back and show you. Okay, so there you have it. It's just so pretty, isn't it? Just gives you a whole different dimension. Just a different dimension. Here you can see I mounted some hotfix Swarovski crystals on here, and that's going to give a little more extra pop and sparkle when you hang it. And the next thing we're going to do after this is put the hardware in and mount it to the back of the through this. We're going to put a hole through here and put the hardware through, then mount it to the board on the shadow box frame, and you will be ready to go. It's going to be so pretty. Okay, and here's the finished result inside a shadow box frame. Absolutely beautiful. Just so pretty. Thank you for joining me today. I hope you learned a lot, and I'll see you on my next project.